Hello, I'm Doug Muzio. This is City Talk. Follow the money, said Deep Throat. Show me the money, said Cuba Gooding Jr. and Jerry Maguire. I ain't got no money, honey, said the Big Bopper. It's budget time in New York. To help us follow the money and to tell us where it ought to come from and where it ought to go are Diana Fortuna, president of the Citizens Budget Commission, and E.J. McMahon, senior fellow at the Manhattan Institute. Both are the people you go to find out about the New York State and New York City economy, finances, and budget. In fact, Diana offset said, budgets are fun. Welcome back, Diana. Welcome, E.J. Monday, State Supreme Court Judge DeGrasse issued his ruling, and that was essentially what the three-person review board proposed. What does this decision mean for New York State, New York City? What's the impact here, EJ?
Well, it's not like a sudden or new development. It's when the stock market, you hear the stock market is already discounted for some event. This was expected. He's been pretty much on the side of the plaintiffs all along. He was expected to do this. It throws another element into the budget process of problems to deal with, but it's not an unexpected problem. I think that it would have been more of a surprise if it hadn't come out
exactly the way it did. Now, what is, as it came out, what kind of dollars are we talking about here, Diana?
Huge. When you focus only on the city, it's $5.5 billion, but most observers think you end up grossing that up to go statewide. So we're talking about $9 billion a year, ultimately phased in over a few years.
And that doesn't even cost the capital construction.
Well, that includes the debt service on the capital.
Okay.
So that would be,
okay,
yeah,
at least that.
And $9 billion is modest because the Albany math on school aid customarily is, you can't break geographic shares, and that means two will get you three, which equals five, usually. If they actually gave the city $5.6 billion, they'd be lucky to get away with spending a total of only nine.
Unbelievable.
So it's terra incognita, I guess. We don't know whether the three leaders in Albany are going to get their act together at some point and try and take some more control of this away from the judiciary, although with each passing action, it gets more and more difficult to have a political solution instead of a judicial one.
Right. I mean, the legislature has really abdicated responsibility. I mean, and so has the governor, in fact.
Well, it depends on who you ask. I mean, remember, these are a bunch of people who can barely agree at any point in the year on a budget.
They have a lot of other things.
They find it pretty difficult to agree on anything, much less things that are really big. From the governor's standpoint, he's probably, ironically, the most secure player on the table right now in this game, in the sense that he's got his plan, he's got money behind his plan. Now, some people don't like it, and the money may be spurious. It's this video lottery terminal plan that's kind of itself tied up with a court, the aftermath of a court ruling. But he's got his plan, and he's sticking by it. And he's going to go and appeal and say he's still got the best plan. The other plans that are out there are actually more shaky. Basically, you've got the state assembly saying, moving closer to the direction the plaintiffs want to go and saying, we'll pay for it out of natural revenue growth, which, in fact, doesn't actually work when you add it all up. So the governor's plan is considered stingy by people who are on the side of the plaintiffs and not workable and not real, but he's pretty, comfortable with it.
Okay, so we've got the legislature. What's the story?
Well, it's
how do they move?
Well, you had the three parties, each with a plan. They never sat down
to
come up with anything.
And then
interesting to note that what the judges have come up with is significantly more than what any of the three of them had put on the table, which is a fascinating lesson in political decision making versus judicial. I'm not saying who's right and who's wrong, but if they had managed to reach, if you were interested in keeping the number low, as I think some of the players were, it would have been better to strike almost any deal at that earlier point rather than let it go to the judges.
Why? What explains this irrationality?
We have a totally dysfunctional state government, and people have a lot of different explanations. But it's as EJ said, there's no their ability to get things done is down here, and then you take an issue like CFE, which is one of the most difficult problems that any state can have to fix. How do you fix education finance? And that is way high on the difficulty meter. So you got a state that's not capable of doing the basics and a problem that's extremely sophisticated and difficult.
If the numbers hold up, let's say that the legislature doesn't act and the governor doesn't act and you have a judicially imposed solution, this has got to explode the state budget. It's got to explode, and you've got to have don't you have to have taxes?
We think so. We think there's no way to do this, at least not if you're going to also try to deal with the state's basic fiscal problems. In other words, we're not looking at a state that's in perfect fiscal health, that this is just, well, now we have to finance something new.
What's the outlay about?
Well, $4 billion was the number that the governor just proposed to close for the coming year, and then, of course, they're bigger after that. So, and the state's been balancing, quote-unquote balancing, its budget with a lot of one-time actions. It doesn't actually has been running deficits, if you look at it on a true accounting basis. So you've got big, big fiscal problems underlying that they're not dealing with. If you want to solve those problems and do CFE, there's no way you avoid taxes for CFE, even though that's not what any of them want to say.
And isn't the magnitude of the taxes that would be necessary be astronomical?
Oh, yeah. I mean, if you take what the judge ruled, combine that with what CFE, the organization, recommended be done to comply with the judge's ruling, and they went back a year ago, they had a very detailed plan. If you actually had to finance what they recommended for a statewide solution, you'd be looking at not only the biggest tax increases in New York State's history, you'd be looking at the biggest tax increases in any state's history. I ran like numbers on a number of variations. If let's say you did it all through the income tax, across the board on the income tax, you'd be looking at a state income tax rate of over 10%. We haven't had a rate like that in 30 years. If you did it just on the rich, meaning people making
people like you, no.
Define it over people who make more than me. That's the definition of rich, isn't it? But say people making over $200,000, what the budget division defines as upper income, you'll be looking at a top income tax rate approaching 13%. I mean, that's statewide. In the city, it would be like 16 or 17%.
So what we said is let's look at, before you get to increasing everyone's taxes across the board, looked at what else you could do.
So okay.
we tried to come up with other ways. So we said, okay, are there ways to save money within education? And we thought there were some, that you could maybe consolidate some school districts, the tiny school districts, not easy. You could,
outside of New York
yes,
City.
Yes, you could redistribute some aid, what they like to call Robin Hood, and which is, again, considered politically very difficult, but we think it's the right thing to
do. But as you've pointed out, Robin Hood was a good guy.
Robin Hood was a good guy. He got this bad name in this education issue. I don't know why. So we maybe got $1 billion out of that. Then we looked at gambling. Very tough issue, and our board was certainly divided. But in the end, it is voluntary, unlike a tax. There's a certain amount of New Yorkers leaving the state to go to adjacent states to gamble and give the revenues there. We thought in the end, difficult, but okay, do it. So,
but how stable a source of revenue?
I think over time, you know, less stable than some other things. It's not like the personal income tax is all that stable, depending on what's happening on Wall Street. So we said, go for that. So then we got up to about $3 billion. And what do you do next? We said, well, before you go to across the board, shouldn't you look for areas where taxes aren't applied fairly? So you've got the sales tax on internet sales, which you're supposed to pay that tax, but people don't.
Right.
So you need to cooperate with other states to make that happen. Take a couple of years to figure out how to do that. Very tough issue. But if you did it, you could probably get, you know, several hundred million dollars out of that. So ideas like that we put on the table. But then we ran out of those types of ideas after about $5-6 billion. So at that point, you have to go to either the income tax or the sales tax. And it's big because, you know, our taxes are high in New York. Although, interestingly, state taxes are not relatively high. It's the local taxes that are high.
But the major state tax, the income tax by any standard, which is the state's major source of revenue, we're more dependent on it than any other state, is high. Okay. I mean, no matter how you measure it, it's not the highest. It's among the two or three highest, for depending on which income group you're looking at and how you measure it. But it's high. All right, it's already high. More than you'd pay in Jersey, for instance, you being most people who are watching this. All right, the sales tax is low, quote unquote, for the state only because it's levied in combination with local sales taxes.
Right.
Combined, it's very high.
Right.
All right. Those are the two major revenue sources. You get beyond that, and you're talking about this business tax and that levy and this gasoline tax. And
not enough to give you big bucks.
Look, if you simply shifted local Medicaid costs, which is another issue we have yet to talk about, from the local level to the state level, and goosed up our share of education spending a little bit to be the national average, you'd be looking at the top state tax burden in the country. It's simply a question of which pocket you're paying it out of. And speaking of Medicaid, when you're talking about financing this school thing, a lot of people now are seeing the commercials that suggest, you know, they're going to pull the hospital bed right out from under you if George Pataki. I don't want to shock you.
Oh,
but you're having this big battle in Albany over cost containment and Medicaid. And by the way, if you do the governor's cost containment, the state share of Medicaid still grows 13%. I mean, that's how bad it is. And if you're talking about paying for CFE, the legislature can't pay for the full restoration in Medicaid that they want to do without a lot of stress. So
this just cascades. We can't pay for the education. We can't pay for Medicaid. We can't pay for pensions forever. We can't pay. What happens? The mayor in his budget address, at the end of his address, at least recognized that there is this phenomenon that you folks always talk about, structural imbalance. Let's just talk about what is structural imbalance and explain how the state has this massive structural imbalance.
Well, they've been stitching it together since the recession hit in 2001. They did things like the tobacco settlement that all states benefited from, where there was a stream of payments states were supposed to get for 25 years. They securitized it, which means they sold bonds so that they could take all the benefit up front in a year or two. And that was a very imprudent thing for them to do. Things like that, and they keep looking to those one-time sources of revenue, and when you do that, it means that your ongoing revenue and your ongoing expenses don't match each other, and both the city and the state have big problems that way.
What's the extent of the problem, and how do you get out of it?
Well, it's like a household, to use another analogy. If you think of all of your household expenses, what you shop for, what cable package you pick, you know, the food you buy, how often you go out to dinner, what kind of car you drive or don't drive. If you add it all together and it's constantly, you know, 5 or 10% more than you actually earn, even including, say, your annual bonus, if you work for an employer who gives one, you're like one of those families, and there are sadly many, who are, you know, accepting every credit card offer that comes in the mail and refinancing and re-refinancing, et cetera. That's what the state and city are like. Now, the mayor has this sort of schizophrenic thing going on with the budget.
Go ahead.
The former corporate executive and the mayor loves to come up with new ways of illustrating just what the financial situation is. The politician who's running for re-election wants to make you think that he's really fixed everything and things are a lot better than they would be if he wasn't there. So in his latest budget, and every year he comes up with a new chart that gives you a better idea of what's going on. He's great in this.
Yeah,
this
is.
Year he had a chart in his preliminary budget presentation, which is fascinating, where for the first time they disentangled something that Rudy Giuliani, for instance, used to scream at the Citizens Budget Commission for trying to point out, which was, When you disentangle like the one-shots and the gimmicks and look at recurring expenditures and recurring revenues, that they are well over $3 billion in the hole on a recurring basis. And it's gotten much worse the last few years and gets worse in the out years. Now, that's...
So serves, he recognizes
he's
it.
He's recognizing and... it. It serves a political purpose for him because it's a warning to the unions saying, hey, where do you think I'm going to get the money for this big contract you want, on the one hand? On the other hand, it kind of... puts him in a box. It also puts all his opponents in a box because what he pointed out was ultimately, no matter what you read in the paper about budget surpluses sometimes, which are basically more money than the plan called for in a given year, there's no such thing as a surplus when ultimately you're $3 billion in the hole. And he faces up to that. Unfortunately, I don't think he deals with it adequately, but I mean, he's very, you know, the truth in advertising is very good here.
Yeah, but he admits that it's structurally imbalanced and then proposes a budget that doesn't meet his criteria.
Perpetuates the structural imbalance.
What could the mayor do to address it? And going to the state level, which seems to me worse, you have to talk to, you know, educate me about that. Talk about the city level.
Well, the city's in an interesting box because of the state in many, many ways. And the mayor has talked about this a lot. And that is the notion that he's got two budgets, if you will. He's got half of it that he calls controllable and half that he calls uncontrollable. And you really can quibble with that, because to think of now more than half the budget, because that's that one half is growing and one half is not.
And the half that's growing is this non-discretionary, right, mandated debt service, pensions,
it's what he
Medicaid.
Has to pay, and he says he, right, doesn't control. And he actually said in the budget presentation, you know, the city now doesn't control more than half its budget.
And that's an apt characterization?
Well, I would say it's overblown. It's, in the long run, everything's controllable. Your pension bill is controlled by not only what the state law is, but also by how many workers you've had. The health insurance costs are the same way. The debt service by what you borrow and how you refinance. Some of them are on a much longer lead time than,
right,
others. But
I mean,
it's a rhetorical device to say that there are others who have a lot of control over the city's fate, which of course is true, and that Maine, I mean, the unions are one of the external bodies of federal government, but the big one is the state, and the city and state have this incredibly complicated, entwined relationship, and it goes in CFE, you see it again.
Right.
Yes. I mean, well, there's this thing that goes on in city politics where, and you see it now between Giff Miller, the council's speaker, and the mayor, where people are attacking the mayor and saying, you're not criticizing Washington and Albany harshly enough, you Republican, you. Why aren't you jumping on them for not giving us more aid or for doing this or that?
I've said it without the Republican, but go ahead.
Okay. Now, be that as it may, these uncontrollable costs the mayor is pointing to are in part the outgrowth of Albany politics that reflects the same politics that's going on here, particularly organized labor politics and the pensions, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody, you don't hear the same people jumping on the mayor for, in effect, not jumping uglier with the state over the pension issue, which you could make the same criticism.
Mm-hmm.
How come you're not really screaming at them and using a few obscenities about the pension issue? I mean,
this may be political advice to the mayor. We should send them a tape.
Well, you know, the fact is, his own style is not to do that with anyone because it doesn't ultimately get you anywhere. I think he's probably more right than wrong about that.
I don't believe in this.
There's a lot of disingenuousness around. It's like Ed Koch has a great story about that, about with the pensions, about where they come to him and announce to him, you know, you've screamed a little too loud about the pension thing, so you know we're going to tweak it downward a little bit, but you know, we expect you to eat it and like it. And at the end of the day, he had to just shut up and accept it because there was nothing he could do about it.
Well, if you think about it, we've had some different mayors with some very different styles in dealing with Albany. The problems haven't changed in their basic character, which is that a lot of times the city has to kind of eat whatever comes down from Albany. You had Koch, who was always outraged. You had Dinkins, who was very courtly. You had Giuliani, who was super tough and threatening, and now you've got Bloomberg, who wants to do business and wants to, I wouldn't quite go to courtly, but is, you know, someone who feels like you can have a civilized conversation. There's an argument that those
Wait a minute, this is politics. What are you talking about?
Listen,
civilized
you want to talk about politics, this has gotten him one thing. He got out of this politics, I would suggest, one of the most outrageous, indefensible fiscal abuses ever committed in New York State.
You're not going to say what I thought.
Right, I thought you were going to say control of the school system.
That's what I was
going
to say.
The other thing he got two things. He got control of the school system early.
Right.
More recently, he'd be $500 million more in the hole each year for the past couple of years and gone out.
Oh, yeah.
The state of New York, you know, went out and, you know, is going to go out and borrow, you know, do a bond issue. It's going to cost them $5 billion. And, you know, somebody's grandchild who's not yet born in Syracuse is going to be paying a sliver of sales tax to repay the MAC debt from the 1970s. And that, I mean, that's one of the most outrageous fiscal abuses either. It's not his fault,
right,
but his political, not at all. He grabbed for what he could get.
Right.
The fact that they gave it to him, that they were willing to do that, and there were other ways to save the money.
So the mayor's strategy of, you know, speaking softly and carrying a big carrot.
That was a good deal for the city's budget.
It wasn't a good deal.
Well, I mean, maybe it even was a bad deal for city taxpayers in the sense that they'll be, as you say, paying for the 70s fiscal crisis for another 30 years, which is unfair to future generations. But it helped the city's budget. And so in a narrow sense, he didn't dream up that nutty scheme. It was Albany.
Well, I think they may have had a role in dreaming it up. But what I'm saying is that his posture, his approach to relationships in Albany worked in that case.
Right.
He got what he wanted.
I can't imagine any mayor would have gotten that out of particularly the Senate that I can think of in prior years, no matter how big. Dinkins never was in worse trouble at some points and never
absolutely.
Got any favor.
Absolutely.
That
absolutely. Looking at the city budget that the mayor proposed was really a good news budget. I mean, in many ways. I mean, clearly
it was a good news butt.
The good news, but okay, give us the good news and give us the but.
I think in certain ways, I mean, obviously, when you put together a budget, you're mindful of where you are in the political cycle,
and this
is a year when clearly the mayor's thinking about his public image, and it's not a very difficult budget, I guess I would say. He's taken some very tough actions early on. He was handed a very difficult budget situation at a difficult time. It's almost like they're taking a break this year, and they know they've got a structural problem.
Good timing.
And they know they're going to be back to figure out some problems they haven't quite figured out. But I think for the moment, they're looking for some calm seas for the next several months because they need it to be calm. So, yes, there are problems, but let's think about them next year.
I heard they were lighting candles in every religious institution in the city to hope that the economy keeps going. Is that the reason the economy and real estate taxes?
The thing is,
and we have to get to taxes.
Well, this is a chicken and the egg thing because too often the attitude of politicians is, you know, we're going to hope that the economy keeps going, and meanwhile we'll do some more things to it that maybe will stop it.
Is that happening?
Well, I don't think it helps. I don't think that the tax increase, the temporary tax increases Albany did a few years ago helped. It would help. I don't think it would help if they extended them, which the mayor is notably silent on.
Right.
Speaking of politics.
Right. Well, somebody's got to pay for CFA.
Well, I mean, again, that will not help economic growth in the city. This is the most heavily taxed place in the most heavily taxed region in the country. And there is kind of a disconnect here between like the mayor's rhetoric and reality in some cases that reflects his background. There was a great quote from Ed Schuyler, his press secretary, in the paper a few weeks ago that said, it was about the Verizon deal staying in the city, but just apropos of in general, Ed said, the mayor can't understand why any business wouldn't want to be in New York City. Now, I happen to think
you have 17 reasons.
Right. I happen to think that that is actually a true expression. I've heard Bloomberg enough on this. I don't think he honestly can think that. Certainly, he couldn't have built his company without being in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
That's the blind spot, mm-hmm. the huge blind spot he has, because there's plenty of reasons why plenty of businesses don't want to be in New York City.
Yeah. He thinks of marketing New York City as kind of a luxury good among cities.
Yeah, there's New York hubris about this.
Well, and there is
a niche
of businesses for whom that's true.
Any argument of that sort, there's enough truth in it to make it plausible, but it's very, very wrong, in my opinion. And I think it's also a dangerous one because it's the kind of thinking that went even into the Fun City era, which was, we can just keep heaping abuse on this and look at it. I mean, you can beat it to death and it's still great.
Yeah, but the times, they have changed.
The times have changed.
We recognize that.
But the danger is that things are so much better, which is great,
right,
is that people will think that the economy is simply invulnerable to whatever you can do to it. And I don't think that's the case.
Okay, but the next year, the out years gap is still projected at, what, $3.7 billion, something like that? How do we deal with these large and in some cases growing out year gaps? What must a prudent chief executive or a prudent city government do?
Well, they've got to start to talk about curbing spending in a more real way than they've done. He's cut planned spending a lot, over $3 billion at this point. But most of it is not spending money growth that didn't happen, if you will. So they've got to do more there, but they've got to have some cooperation from Albany, again, a daunting prospect. But I would say the pension area is one where they've got to get started on. And it's a hard one because the constitutional protections for pensions are such that any significant savings would be years and years down the road.
Mm-hmm.
So mayors tend to kind of step back from it because they would take a lot of political heat for it, and yet you wouldn't see the savings for, you know, until the next mayor or the mayor after.
Sure.
But you hope that they do it anyway because it's the right thing to do.
EJ, add to that?
Well, I mean, I totally agree with that. And the thing you don't do, I think, is raise taxes further. It's interesting the discussion over the stadium and the West Side development, which we haven't gotten into.
Go ahead. That's the next
one. It kind of
one.
Touches both sides of this issue. People like us who kind of think budgets are fun, which is kind of sick when you think about it, but that's true.
But delightfully sick.
Are interested to see, always interested to be reminded that the general public is willing to believe that $600 million or $1 billion in bonded spending is $1 billion you could be giving in raises to cops. And on the one hand, I'm not unhappy to have people thinking that way because people are, they are conscious that, you know, it's all money and it does
and there are trade-offs.
On the other hand, there isn't $1 billion in raises to give in cops. I happen to not think the stadium is a good idea for other reasons. But yes, there's a fat, bloated capital budget, both on the charts and in people's imaginations in the future. But then there's also this operating budget that is very tight, that has this budget gap without even considering that anything close to the type of raises the unions really want.
Okay, so you're saying it's tight. Without that, what does a responsible chief executive do?
He tries to curb that uncontrollable budget by the pensions, the health insurance. We're paying benefits to retired New Yorkers.
But we're telling him to get it from Albany.
I think the thing is you got to make a leap into, because your problem with Albany is that Albany is so bad in all the ways we know it. There's been generations of mayors saying, hey, this pension bill is crazy.
Right.
And something ought to be done. But you got to make a leap over, an area that he's been unwilling to go. You got to start looking at things like, hey, you know, we could save money on sanitation by competitively contracting it. I know that it's quote unquote not done in New York, but if you want to save money, you got to start doing things differently. There have been a lot of reports, for instance, the CBC has issued on productivity savings that are available in a number of areas, some of which require collective bargaining, some don't.
Right.
Some you can, look, Rudy got the second set of concessions that anybody ever got out of the sanitation workers, actually both times, I think were due to the fact that sanitation workers were at least aware that they could easily have competition for what they do.
Right.
Well, we just like with great fanfare launched a new Staten Island ferry for a service that we give away free at a cost of $3 a ride, which by the way has a slew of companies in the business of privately operating.
So one of solutions is privatization.
Not simply privatization is almost too simplistic a term.
Okay.
Competitive contract.
Okay. Okay.
And this
Fair
is
enough.
An area he has not gone to at all.
Okay. Okay. Last minute. We haven't discussed this at all. Who pays for this CFE decision? The mayor says, the corp council says, not us. You've got to do it. What's going to happen?
Well, what's going to happen, I suspect, is that the mayor will end up having to pay a piece of it, but he shouldn't. It's not fair. I mean, yes, it's true. In the end, you know, it's the individual taxpayers that end up paying it, not the jurisdiction, but the city's already, its taxes are sky high. This is the kind of burden that should be spread statewide.
Agree?
The simple answer is we all live in New York and the people watching us live in New York. The answer is we will and you will. I mean, at the end of the day, there's going to be a number that people are, and that's going to be paid for by taxpayers all over the state through their local taxes, in the case of the city's taxes, and state taxes.
So no way is not the way. This is going to happen. City residents are going to not only pay their taxes to the state, but the jurisdiction is going to have to
pay. If you have a confined solution that is much smaller than this, which I would argue for other reasons you could, and actually accomplish better results in the schools, there are
ways. Which we haven't touched on at all, but go ahead.
But there are ways, if you were lucky in terms of economic growth and really clamped down on the rest of the budget, state and the city, that you could increase spending without straining yourself too much.
Okay. Two words of advice to the mayor, budget?
Go after those uncontrollables. They got to be controlled.
Okay. Thank you. Wonderful.